You are watching Notepad, and I'm your host, Ibrahim Sani. So I just got back from the United States after witnessing the launch of a slew of products from Apple. You all know the hardware launches, iPhone 11, a new iPad, Apple Watch 5th series and more. But today we shall focus more on Apple's aggressive pivot into subscription. Joining me very shortly is Stephen Innes, the Asia Pacific market strategist from ExiTrader, to talk more about Apple's subscription business. But now let's talk a little bit more about the two new subscription services that Apple is launching this week, starting with Apple TV Plus. Apple's aggressive pricing of TV Plus at $5 or 20 ringgit divided the bulls from the bears. Bulls like Morgan Stanley praised the pricing as a competitive advantage in a crowded streaming market. Their argument is that the sacrifice of near-term revenue would be offset by building a base of millions of subscribers, some of them new. Now, meanwhile, Nomura said that the lower-than-expected pricing would definitely cut into Apple's margins and added that the free year of TV Plus subscription with an iPhone purchase was unlikely to drive hardware upgrades. This is what they think. Now, to couple with this, Walt Disney's chief executive, Robert Iger, resigned from Apple's board of directors recently, severing a years-long connection between the two companies as they prepare to launch competing video streaming services, Disney being Disney Plus. We all know the pricing is about $7 for now. How do we make sense from all this new pivot into subscriptions? To answer this and more, Stephen Innes, the Asia-Pacific market strategist at ExiTrader, joins me now. Stephen, Apple shares are surging up 2.8%, and now they are hovering at about $220 to put Apple's market value back above the $1 trillion for the first time since November last year. This is an increase of 41% this year. What's driving this surge?
Incredible story, really. I mean, if we look at the equity markets in general, there's been a lot of doom and gloom. There's been a lot of this talk about the overhang from trade war, but we look at tech sectors. They seem to be the Teflon equities of global equity markets, Apple being the heavyweight champion of the U.S. markets. What that tells me is that there's still demand for iPhones. iPhones make 48% of their revenue. People are still buying them. People will still want them. But overlying, what's happening here, in my view, is that the Federal Reserve Board is just providing such a cushy environment with lower interest rates that investors can't help but trip over themselves. And when investors want to buy equities, they go for growth equities. And what better growth equity is there on the planet than Apple? That's my view on why Apple is doing so well over the past year and probably will continue to do well in years ahead.
There were fears about slowing iPhone sales and the impact of trade tensions between the US and China. Do you expect strength in its services business to continue supporting their bottom line and supporting their revenue?
You know, it's an interesting pivot they're making. They're coming in at such an affordable entry point. But we have to remember that Apple has probably nailed down the demographics quite succinctly and applying them to a specific group of clients that they feel that they're going to attract to this service. It's going to be a high-end service, going to have a lot of gloss. But this entry point, in my view, is very attractive. Not only are they offering the sweetener with the new products, and perhaps the more is correct, it may not spur on new sales, but it provides an instant base. And I think this is getting back to Morgan Stanley's argument, is that this base is something to springboard off. And I do believe at this affordable entry point, even people like myself that aren't Apple consumers might actually use a Mac to subscribe to this product because it sounds interesting, it sounds intriguing, and it sounds like something that perhaps even a brand loyalist from a different brand might even move over and take their chance with Apple this year.
Taking the shift away from retail business and consumers, people like you and me, let's focus a little bit about the corporate side. there are still some ongoing tussle in the various courthouses in Europe, particularly when it comes to anti-competition laws. In fact, a few hours before we started this show, there was a court in Ireland that is contesting the anti-competition laws against Apple. Do you think that all this is going to, you know, bring down the kind of outlook for Apple? How long do you think they will continue to have this halo effect?
Well, you know, it's interesting. The halo effect's one thing. I think we can look back years and years, and Apple has such brand loyalty among its actually fervent consumers. They won't buy anything else. But when it gets into the same anti-competition legislation, this is where it gets extremely complicated. Let's face it, they are crowding out a lot of the competition. That's for sure. And it makes that entry, it makes that competitive space that much difficult to enter. Basically, they control the space from top to bottom, totally vertically integrated. Everybody has to play by their rules. Everybody has to play along with what they want. And this is a bit of a problem. But will the Irish court be able to actually have an influence over global jurisdiction? That's the big issue right now. So we'll have to see how this plays out. But if we're talking about Apple in the court of public opinion, I think that's where Apple succeeds. I don't think they're going to lose any brand loyalty as a result of this injunction.
Stephen, there's also some talks about the competition. You touched a little bit about it. Right after the launch, at least in the States, we saw an immediate uptick in Apple's shares and their direct competition in terms of streaming. We're talking about Roku, Disney, as well as Netflix, actually took a dip. And they've since recovered, but it's actually not there yet. It's still trending downwards. Do you think that this is going to continue, even if even when Disney launches their services product and subscription product just a few months from now?
Well, you know, you get the honeymoon effect. Obviously, getting back to why the shares have jumped up, I think the new phones are doing surprisingly well based on the orders that they're receiving. And that's a bit of a surprise, given the fact there's very little new technology, and I had a G5. You know, they don't even include that technology. And, you know, lots of us had thought that perhaps consumers would hold off. But maybe consumers are thinking, like I do, that we don't want to buy the new wave of technology, pay $2,000 for a product that might end up getting sent back to the manufacturer or might not be compatible with every carrier in the U.S. So there's these issues. But I think getting back to the subscription, and this is really what we're focusing on here, it's a very competitive landscape. I see the price drop actually helping out the consumers in the sense that all these other brands are going to have to look at themselves in the mirror and say, how can we compete with a $4.99 price point? Are we going to have to either, one, improve our services, or two, are we going to have to drop our prices down? The person and the people who are going to end up the winner here is the consumer, and I think that's a good thing.
There's also talks of how they are rolling this out across a lot of countries from the get-go. It's crazy. I mean, 150 countries with a catalogue of over, say, for instance, Apple Arcade, 100 games. Do you think that this is going to just grab more competition from the market? You think that competition is going to be more aggressive in trying to outdo Apple?
Well, I think it has to because, again, looking at the demographics here, they're appealing to a specific higher-end demographics. The games that they're actually coming out with on the game platform are not just for kids, not just for middle age. It's for the whole group here, you know, from kids all the way up to seniors. So this is interesting. This is an interesting concept. Whether this catches on, I think it will. Whether this forces further development from other companies, I think it does also. And again, I think this is a win-win situation for the consumer. But again, are we in a state where we're going to see overpromise and underdeliver? This is what I'm yet waiting to see, and you know, and so-called kick tires and see how these products actually work out. But what I think is interesting this time around, unlike probably like you and I have subscribed to some type of games before, where you know we played it for about 20 days and said, we didn't really like this, but then we get hit at the end of the month with a renewal contract that we forgot about. This time around, Apple's actually safeguarding. It is a trial. You're not going to be held responsible. So this point of entry makes this a lot even friendlier versus the old games where if you forgot you signed up, you're going to end up paying down bill at the end of the month. So So I think it's a good concept. I think it's a very approachable concept, and I think it's going to sell quite well.
Right. Let's hope that they didn't overpromise, I guess. That would be such a bummer for consumers like you and I. Thanks, Stephen. That was my conversation with Stephen Innes, the Asia-Pacific strategist at ExitTrader. We'll take a short break. But when we come back, we'll discuss a little bit more about Apple Arcade. Don't go anywhere.